Welcome to today's webinar from the Federal Reserve System on the front lines against synthetic identity payments fraud. I'm delighted to participate in today's event as a member of the Fed's industry relations team. Our agenda is shown on slide two, if you could forward the slide. The Federal Reserve's Jim Cunha will begin with some key findings of the Federal Reserve's initial white paper on synthetic identity payments fraud, which was published in July. Then we'll hear perspectives on synthetic identity fraud from the FBI and the industry. Our three panelists will then have the opportunity throughout to answer questions from the audience. We will be taking questions, and you can submit them at any time during our call. If you've joined us via the webinar, just click on the Ask Question button. We'll get your questions queued up for our speakers today. With that, let me ask that you move along to slide three, and I will introduce our panelists. Jim Cunha is Senior Vice President at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston and one of the leaders of our payment security strategy. His numerous other jobs include leadership of the Boston Fed's wholesale, mobile, and digital payments, as well as our efforts in exploring digital currencies, distributed ledger technology, and blockchain. Zach Baldwin is a supervisory special agent for the FBI. He serves in the money laundering, forfeiture, and bank fraud unit. Zach will talk at a high level about the growing issue of synthetic identity fraud, including the very important question of how and when financial institutions should report suspected fraud to the FBI. Amy Walraven is CEO and Chief Analytics Officer for Turnkey Risk Solutions. TRS is a business-to-business risk management company that develops tools and services to protect organizations from first-party fraud risks. In other words, Amy has a lot to tell us about how she's worked with financial institutions and law enforcement to investigate synthetic identity payments fraud. Before I move on, let me thank Zach and Amy again for joining our webinar today. We also thank all of you who took time out of your busy day to spend an hour with us to discuss payment security. Again, if you have questions during this webinar, please submit them electronically. We'll answer questions at several points within the webinar and at the end. With that, let's move to slide four and turn the webinar over to Jim.
Thank you, Mariana, I appreciate it. As Mariana mentioned, I'm Jim Cunha, Senior Vice President of the Boston Fed, and with my boss, Ken Montgomery, who is our Chief Operating Officer, we run the Fed's secure payment work, and the synthetic identity research is just one of a number of different initiatives we have going. So we encourage you to look to our website, which is noted at the end of the presentation, for the other efforts. And let me add my thanks to Mary Ellen's for all of you joining. Before we jump into the slide, though, I just want to mention a little background. It was a little over a year ago we identified synthetic identity fraud as an area where we felt the Fed could help add value to the industry. What we found was, through talking to small, medium financial institutions, that probably no more than 10 or 15% had ever heard of synthetic identity fraud or had programs specifically in place to implement them. So we thought that the best thing we could do at the initial parts of this was to help educate the industry. So for this past year, we've been talking to industry experts like our fellow panelists here. And then we published a white paper just about a month or so ago, so I encourage you to read it if you haven't already. And next, we'll be publishing another white paper probably in the mid-October time frame, getting deeper into some of the mitigation strategies and other things that can help to discover synthetic identity fraud. And then at year-end, early next year, we'll put another paper out talking about what we think the Fed can do with the industry to try to make progress against thwarting this type of fraud. One of the other things we found out is that there's no standard fraud definition, and which is part of the problem. And so here on this page, we have a working definition we have just to get the conversation going on synthetic identity fraud. So as it mentions here, this is really a crime that involves taking either a real or a fake Social Security number and then really creating a fake person around that Social Security number in order to defraud financial institutions. It could either be totally fabricated information about a person, it could be PII that's been stolen through breaches, or it could be some combination. So there's different ways of creating this identity. But as an example, what would happen is they would take the Social Security of say, my granddaughter, who's three, she's not using it, and they create a fake person around it. So to a financial institution, it may look like a real person, and the ultimate goal here is to build up a good credit score for this synthetic identity, and then eventually go after the big payout, the big bust out, where the real financial implications are for financial institutions. And so you may ask, why, how can this happen? What are some contributing factors? Well, probably is many in the financial system use the Social Security number as an identifier. And as most of us know, that was never the intended value when it was created. It was created to track Social Security benefits. And also that number, as they were issued, was randomized back in 2011. Used to be able to tell the location where someone was born when they were issued the Social Security number as part of the number. And now they're totally randomized, and that created a challenge in trying to identify the person with the Social Security number. As we all know, there's been tons of PII that's been stolen through breaches, and that's what's been used to create these synthetic identities in some cases. And then the credit processes, which we'll talk about towards the end, never really were built for this type of a fraud. You know, they were built for basic know your customer and validate that, you know, the information you had pointed to a creditworthy person, but they weren't really built with this in mind. If you go to the next goal, next page. So one of the challenges we had, and this tells a little more detail, is that the information is available at a very low cost in the dark web. So if you want to piece a person together, this is some of the information that the fraudsters will use to actually create it. As you can see here, you know, the fact that it's a dollar for particular pieces of information, Social Security number, passports, relatively cheap, diplomas, you can actually piece together what looks like a real individual through this information that can be bought on the dark web. So that's part of the problem. Let's move to the next slide. So in talking about the scope of the problem, and I have one major caveat here, there's really not a lot of good data about synthetic identity fraud for a number of reasons. And this is not a slam against this data specifically. It's just saying that we haven't had, you know, the normal type of research and reporting out of the financial institutions and others that will give us a better sense of the data. And it is still a relatively new type of fraud. As I mentioned here, it's reported as the fastest growing fraud in financial services. Most of the fraud which is captured is not caught through the normal means, and that's because the identities and the transactions look actually normal. That's part of the problem. We all know the volume of PII that's been stolen is growing dramatically, so there's just more to work with. And this is a scary one. Up to 1 million children have had their Social Security number compromised through these or other identity theft types of schemes. So I encourage everybody to lock your child's or your grandchild's or your grandnieces and nephews' Social Security numbers until they need them, because these are the real people that are hurt by this in the end outside of the financial institutions when they go to apply for credit. There's an estimate that 20% of all credit losses were actually attributed to synthetic identities, and that's a big number. The $6 billion number in the bottom middle here saying what the actual cost is back in 2016, I wouldn't really dwell on the $6 billion specifically, except that we know it's a big number. There's not been a lot of research to corroborate this particularly, but when you talk about that type of number, we know it's a big problem, and it's definitely growing. Here's an average of $15,000 per bust out for these identities, and we've heard others anecdotally talking about more upwards of $20,000 per incident in this area. It's also worth noting that outside of financial services, which is obviously the Fed's concern and why we're on this call, these identities are also creating problems in auto loans, medical services, government benefits, etc. So this goes way beyond just the financial services world into many other areas. If you could advance it one more. So this is a simplistic way of looking at the life cycle. And as you think about how I described how this account is created, the identity is created, when there's an enrollment process, these are built to pass KYC and customer information identification program checks, for the most part, because they weren't built with this in mind. So once the actual credit account is created, the credit record is created, you know, now it's in the system with a Social Security number that's matched to a synthetic identity. When you get to the transaction level and you're looking at actual flows of transactions, it looks like a valid person and valid transactions. This is a lot about how the bad guys do their job. But what we are detecting is that even the patterns of the bad guys in the synthetic world are starting to have their own signatures. And so it's not that they're totally undistinguishable, but their differences from normal patterns of payments are very subtle. So it's not easy to detect. And also on the end, when someone has a bust out, a lot of times these do look like regular credit losses. It looks like somebody walking away from an account, so it's just a normal credit loss, or it's reported that someone's identity was stolen, and actually it's the synthetic identity itself that's reporting this, and because that's what it looks like. The bust out looks like that's the crime right there versus the whole synthetic identity. And so as you can see from the life cycle, we still have a ways to go to try to identify the particular attributes that start to lead to this type of fraud. And I'll end with just one comment I make whenever I talk about this is, when you think about cybersecurity in the financial industry, it's really treated like us against the bad guys. You know, everybody comes together to try to thwart those big cyber crimes against financial institutions. But in fraud, we don't really work the same way. It's not really everybody against the bad guy, because people are generally working within their own institution trying to prevent their fraud against their own institutions and their customers, which is very understandable. But this is the type of fraud that really has tentacles that affect many institutions and affect many different types of assets out there besides just loans and credit. So I try to use that as a rallying cry to say that this should be the burning platform we can all come together on. So with that high-level view of what we found in our white paper, let me just turn it over to Zach to give his perspectives. Zach?
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Zach Baldwin. I'm a supervisory special agent with the FBI's Money Laundering, Forfeiture, and Bank Fraud Unit out of our headquarters in Washington, D.C. I guess to start, I'd just like to give you a little background about what my specific unit does and how it kind of relates to the topic for today. My unit does is manages both the FBI's money laundering and bank fraud program, obviously, and we support all money laundering and bank fraud investigations throughout the Bureau. We also lead the criminal investigative division's arm of our virtual currency emerging threats working group. And what we do with that is we manage all the virtual currency programs, trainings, the cases worked in the field, and other program activities bureau-wide. Specifically within our program, the main focus, I guess if I were to sum it up, is working with our field offices, in addition to federal, state, local, and international law enforcement partners, to investigate, disrupt, and dismantle money laundering facilitators, criminal organizations, and individual operations engaged in fraud schemes, which target our nation's financial institutions, all of which are utilizing synthetic identities to commit fraud. So today, I can talk a little bit about the role that the FBI is playing in combating synthetic identity fraud. And what we do is kind of a two-prong approach, where there's kind of that proactive and reactive approach. Proactively, our main focus tends to be education and outreach. So what people don't know what's out there, they don't know how to combat it. So we just want to educate people what to look for and how to deal with it. That's both at the law enforcement level, the regulatory level, and the private sector level. So we provide, to do that, we provide training with our own agents. We provide training to other agencies, other organizations, international partners. We take part in task force and working groups. These working groups consist both of law enforcement, regulatory, and private sector personnel. In those working groups, we like to share best practices, ideas we have, what we're seeing, trends, red flags, and other investigative methods and techniques that we use that we feel is best to thwart this problem. Often we like, especially at the FBI, is to collaborate. It's not only a force multiplier, but it brings different perspectives to the table. With the private sector, we like to meet individually or in groups with other units in my division, in my agency, and we again discuss trends, typologies. My unit will go into financial institutions and we'll go over their processes. We'll have discussions about their account setups, how they conduct monitoring, how they write their SARs, what they're seeing. We can discuss at a high level what everyone else is seeing. At the field office level, we like to engage with the local and regional private sector financial institutions and financial services. We'll invite them to our field office and give presentations and have discussions. Reactively, obviously, we conduct our typical investigation, the ones you see on TV, where crime has been committed, there's a victim. We open a grand jury investigation, and we find the bad guy. Not surprisingly, with synthetic ID, our approach is very similar. In some instances, identical to how we tackle investigating traditional fraud schemes. There are a few tweaks, but it's typically the same. So some of these investigations where they're using synthetic IDs, it's similar to a company using or a bad guy using a shell corporation. These synthetic IDs are hiding their true identity like a shell company tries to hide the beneficial owner. So we address that accordingly. This kind of leads into some of the types of frauds we see that are being perpetrated using synthetic identity fraud in the financial sector. Where we're seeing a lot of credit card bust out schemes. This is the main thing we identify with synthetic identity fraud, although it's not the only thing. It's still the significant amount of our case holdings. This typically, for our definition, is when bad actors are taking out lines of credit, they build up their profiles and credit limit, and they ultimately draw down on all these lines or fully extend their lines of credit, they cash out, and then they default. We're seeing a lot of use of collusive merchants where the actors are setting up sham companies and getting payment processors. They then either swipe stolen credit cards or are created credit cards without exchanging any goods. We're seeing a lot of insurance fraud, loan fraud, personal loan, like payday loan fraud, auto loan fraud, e-commerce fraud, and income tax fraud. So it kind of runs the gamut, just to name a few. Also, a lot of times, some of the methods that we see them using in synthetic identity fraud are not actually incurring a loss. They'll use synthetic IDs to create funnel accounts. Again, they'll also use it to create a beneficial owner and then attach it to a shell corporation with the sole intent of using it as part of the money laundering cycle. We've also seen senior leaders of criminal enterprises utilize synthetic IDs just to get payments through some of their criminal enterprises' proceeds. Another important note is that a lot of times these frauds are not standalone frauds. They're used in combination of one another. For example, a credit card bust-out fraud with an auto loan fraud or an e-commerce fraud with a bust-out fraud. And although I can't get too into the weeds on some of the elements we see with the schemes, I can describe at a high level maybe two types of frauds we have seen. One example would be a bust-out scheme in which a criminal group created approximately 2,000 fraudulent profiles using the names, using different names but modifying date of birth and Social Security numbers. In this instance, they took profiles that were and created several demand deposit accounts, which were then opened. They remotely deposited low-dollar checks, usually around $200, We found out they did this to try to avoid any suspicion. Once the funds were deposited, they just moved the funds into a primary account and they spended it. That was a pretty lowbrow scheme, but it's a common one we see. On a little bit of a larger operation, there was a specific fraud ring that targeted credit cards from three specific institutions. They used the typical fraudster playbook where they completed online applications. They applied for certain cards just to get denied to create that profile. Once it was established, they would then obtain low lines of credit with high interest rates. They would then build up their credit score by making purchases. For this unique group, we noticed that a lot of the purchases were to certain vendors within the area they lived in. They did that because it also matched some of the profiles in which they created. They then used collusive merchants for a while until they decided that they didn't want to pay someone else to run the cards, so they created their own sham businesses and obtained merchant terminals. They built up a large enterprise that was run by several individuals, and they caused millions of dollars in losses. Something that was pretty interesting that we see a lot, though, is when we conduct search warrants and we actually see into the operation, a lot of these organizations, they run this like a business. This is their job. This is their only job, a lot of these people do. When we raided some of the businesses, we found large files that contained individual identities that were backstopped completely. They contained fake documents, fake driver's license, passport, credit reports, phone numbers used, email accounts that they used, a whole dossier of these individuals. The other thing I kind of want to talk about is a question we often get, and that's how and when financial institutions should report suspected identity theft fraud to the FBI. I'm going to have to say the answer is pretty easy. It's as soon as possible. You out there are the first line of defense, and you're the experts in your respective fields, so we do lean on you to tell us when you see something unusual. You don't have to wait to file a SAR. You can call my unit, call the FBI directly, and make a referral. You can submit reports through the website that's listed probably on the slide that's showing, www.ic3.gov. You can contact through our local field office, or a lot of your institutions already have contacts with us. So use your institutional contacts. If you don't have a contact and your institution would like one, you can contact us through the Public Affairs Office. I can give you that information later on. So again, the answer is simple about when to contact is as soon as possible. The second most popular question we get is, all right, if we contact you, How do you work with us? How does the FBI work with financial institutions during investigations? The best answer I can give you is as close as possible, but in a manner consistent with the federal rules of criminal procedure. We understand there can be a lot of frustration, and sometimes it may feel like a one-way street when dealing with us, but we're bound by rules, and in order to maintain investigative integrity, we have to act accordingly. So we'll try our best to keep you involved and updated as your case progresses, and we'll work with you as much as we can along the way, but we just ask you to be patient. The one thing I do want to add, especially for some of the financial institutions listening in, is in regards to keep open letters. The FBI understands that the financial institutions need to de-risk, but if you're going to make a decision about de-risking, whether it's closing your account or doing something with one of your holdings, just please consult with us first before taking action, because we may ask you to keep an account open, and we will issue a keep open letter. And lastly, I just kind of want to touch on the value of SARs. I can't stress it enough. SARs are some of the most important pieces of information that come through our agency. Believe it or not, the FBI reviews every single SAR, either manually or through data analytics. We get a dump from FinCEN about once a month, and we go through it. We run this data against our case holdings. If we come up with a match, we notify a case agent. We also run it against IC3 holdings for the complaint center and other complaints that we receive. We use these SARs to generate targeting packages based on terms and identifier found in the SARs. We use this data to develop domain awareness, and we push that domain awareness out to you guys. We also use it to see developments in criminal patterns, typologies, and identify trends through them. That said, again, please keep writing them. We use them, and they are instrumental in our casework and programs. And with that, I think I'm going to pass it on.
Okay, Zach, this is Jim. Just one question before we see if there are audience questions. I mentioned on our sort of data slide that this has been reported, synthetic identity fraud within payments or within financial services has been reported as the fastest growing ever, or fastest growing at this point in time. Do you find that it's growing faster, or are we just more aware of it and discovering it better? Any sense of, is it growing or we're just finding it more?
That's a good question. It's a tough question to answer. I think it might be a little bit of both. As you said, with the data breaches, there's a lot more information available. It's easier to commit some of this fraud. Our criminals are getting more savvy. And as you touched on your white paper, there are also inconsistencies in the definition and how the detection approaches are done, among other measures. So as it may appear, it's growing. It may also be the awareness and the reporting is increasing. So the main point is that, you know, like we're discussing today, we're aware of the problem and we're moving forward as a collective to better understand it, detect it, and mitigate the threat in a more proactive manner.
Great, thanks. Yeah, I think that comes with sort of the nature of where we are. Inconsistent definitions and not great data, but just to focus on it. I appreciate that. Let me just turn it to Mary Ellen and to see if we're in the audience questions.
And we did have several audience questions about SARS, one of which, very truthfully, was to talk a little bit more about what this is, and just some high-level advice in general, potentially about, you know, how to better to code the information or use the information to flag something that could be potentially synthetic identity fraud. So feel free to take that any direction you'd like to go. We had several questions. I'm combining several of them.
Okay, as far as SARS, how to better code it and how to flag it, that's kind of something that would probably be better addressed in a more private forum, and I'd be happy to discuss offline. That's kind of the secret sauce that we like to discuss with financial institutions, and it's something that I prefer not to put out there.
Okay, we had another audience question that really was talking about, you know, would love to have that private conversation, that one-on-one conversation. This was from a West Coast financial institution, and she was asking, or he was asking, you know, how would someone arrange to have someone from the FBI visit a financial institution to help them review processes or better understand how they can be helpful to the FBI?
Absolutely, and thank you for that request. One of the ways you can contact, it could either be offline or through our npo@fbi.gov email address. So that's our public outreach office, and that's our Office of Public Affairs. So to contact them, and you can just use my name or the unit, and they will get in touch with us.
At this point, Jim, I'd like to, I have several additional audience questions, but I would like to ask Amy to talk with us first, and then we will go back to some additional audience questions from here.
Yeah, makes sense. We got 15 minutes towards the end, so that sounds perfect, Mary Ellen.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Amy Walraven. Thank you for having me today. I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of Turnkey Risk Solutions. Prior to founding TRS, I actually worked in the financial services industry for a little over 20 years, primarily focused in the fraud, credit, and compliance realms. The last 10 years of my career at some of the major institutions I worked for was really focused around first-party fraud detection and mitigation efforts and creating different ways to identify them earlier in the life cycle. So we spent a lot of time, and I've been asked today to really talk about how we worked with law enforcement, specifically with the FBI and other agencies, to look into these types of activities and to be able to really focus on being proactive in identifying them or to understand the real risks that the industries are facing from a payments perspective, from a credit perspective, from a compliance perspective, and kind of run the gamut. So one of the things I want to talk about is a case that we had worked on, and if you could advance to the next slide, I would appreciate that, with the FBI, and it really kind of runs the whole gamut of the different types of first-party fraud. And it's a really great primer example of just the level of organization, to Zach's point, to Jim's point earlier, of how organized some of these groups can be, how exposed organizations can be to it, especially if they don't understand that the threats are out there, and that it takes on a lot of different shapes and sizes. So this was a case that myself and Barbara Simcox, who's also a colleague of mine in my previous roles in the financial services sector, as well as here at TRS, had worked directly with the FBI on. And it wasn't just us. It was a lot of collaboration across the FBI, different sister agencies within law enforcement, payment processors, other financial institutions, because this is a very large transnational criminal organized group. In the affidavits and in the indictments, it was 18 core individuals. Those individuals were managing in excess of 7,000 identities. They had opened more than 25,000 credit cards, and credit cards gets the big play, but there was a lot more banking relationships that were involved. There were DDA accounts. There were unsecured lines of credit. There was mortgages, to Zach's point earlier. There was auto loans. There was a lot of different mechanisms in the financial services sector that were impacted by this group. In addition to that, they managed 1,800 and so mailing addresses. So you think of fraud conventionally in the high-risk zip codes or in high-risk states. These guys were really good at understanding that they don't want to just focus in those areas, even though they were there too. But they were in places, 28 different states where the 1,800 mailing addresses were, places like Kansas and Iowa and Idaho, not the ones that you typically think of as fraud hotbeds. Throughout their scheme, they got at least $200 million from the infrastructure, from the financial services sector. We know that at the point where the affidavits were served, we think that that number was significantly higher than that. When it was all told and said, I've never seen a final count, but definitely know that it was at least $200 million or more. And Zach mentioned earlier as well that when they set up these accounts, they basically, in effect, especially this group, created a shadow economy. So not only did they open a bunch of relationships, they had deposit relationships, they had credit and debit relationships, they had loans, they had mortgages, they also created a lot of collusive or sham businesses, synthetic businesses. So some were real, and it's more the back office operations that you need to be concerned about. So they have a separate terminal for those transactions that were related to the synthetics where no goods or services were exchanged. It was just a way to move the money through the accounts. Or they had a completely synthetic business where the only opportunity for that in a sham business was to take the synthetic identity credit cards that they had obtained and run those transactions. Again, no goods or services were exchanged, but it was a way for them to close that loop and to be able to extract the funds without really being detected. In some instances, if they were completely sham merchants, you know, you don't get the video film. You don't get them, you know, going into a store, using the account. You don't get some of the evidence that you potentially need for prosecution. And it's just a faster way for them to be able to make sure they're extracting the funds as they need to. When you talk about synthetic identities or when we talk about synthetic identities, there's definitely the fraud component. There's definitely the loss component. But it's important for people to understand the AML or the money laundering component because these are the proceeds of fraud. And traditionally, money laundering has always been defined as the cash typically that was out on the street that you have to pull through the financial system. And when you're dealing with synthetics, you don't necessarily have to deal with the cash on the street. You can generate that cash by opening an account and then getting the money deposited into whatever account you control and then going from there. So it is still the proceeds of fraud. So it still does have a money laundering implication. One example of that for this group is one terminal that they had at one of the collusive merchants. So it's a real business, does real transactions for real customers, but in the back office, like I said, they have a dedicated terminal. And over the period of 8 months, they had run about 95% of the transactions through that terminal were completely synthetic. No goods or services were exchanged, and they were able to obtain about $386,000 just by running cards in the back room. So they use a lot of different payment mechanisms. I think this case has been talked about a lot of times because it's the biggest one that's been prosecuted to date. And it's not, like I said, just the credit card. You have the debit transactions. There's a lot of check activity that goes along with this type of activity, because when they get money deposited into their merchant account from swiping their synthetic cards, then they write checks out to pay other members of the organization or pay for other parts of the enterprise. There's ATM withdrawals, so that's how they can exfiltrate the funds through cash. There's deposits to help kind of shuffle the money around. There's wires that go overseas. A lot of the money that was part of this scheme was actually wired overseas, and it went to 8 different countries. So it might have started here in the U.S., but then it went to Canada, Pakistan, United Arab Emirates, India, Romania, China, Japan. So it isn't just a financial services issue. It's not just a domestic issue. It's also expanding, and the money is moving outside of our borders and to fund other activity. So that's one big case that we had worked with the FBI, and again, it was a huge opportunity for us to partner with law enforcement to be able to help with the prosecution. These individuals were actually prosecuted. They have spent time. This is an older case. It's one that does show kind of how organized it can be. It's one that also ran for a long time. So a lot of people, because it's new and people are talking about it, and it's more top of mind because it's getting a lot more press, this is actually a case that made the papers in 2013, so it's not a new case. And the activity actually went on for nearly a decade before 2013. So this type of fraud and this type of exploit and this type of abuse in the financial services system has actually been around for a long time. So we're playing catch up as an industry. And to Jim and to Zach's points earlier, this isn't just a financial services issue. It's something that's starting to have implications in the insurance issue or in the insurance space and the healthcare space. Government benefits. There's a lot of different places this is starting to creep up and creep in.
Thanks, Amy. I want to just add on to something you said, because I didn't really emphasize that, and I think in my comments, this is Jim, sort of the amount of time that some of these synthetics are open. I think what we've seen, and I'm sure what you've seen, is that, you know, some of these are nurtured because they're trying to get a good credit score. Sometimes they're nurtured for weeks and months, and sometimes they exist even for years because they're part of an elaborate scheme, as you pointed out in this 2013 example. So, you know, sometimes what we hear from institutions is, well, these accounts have been open for years, there's been traffic, so we know they're real. And so I think that's a lesson that just because it's been open and there's been traffic on it does not mean it's not synthetic. So I just wanted to sort of add on to your comment there. And so in your work, anything particular you'd want to highlight as some of the best practices for trying to prevent the synthetic identities? I know we have a lot of work to do here, but anything that's come your way that you think is worth passing along to our audience?
Absolutely. I think first and foremost, education or understanding the threats is paramount. People need to be able to define it and understand it if they want to be able to solve for it. As well as, I think people also need to understand that there really are no singular silver bullets that are out there. So there is a lot of great technology. There are a lot of great solutions. There's a lot of great tools that are out there, but you need to really take a layered approach and understand that this is a holistic issue. And to the point that you just brought up, it can happen really quickly, or it can happen over days, months, weeks, years. So you have to have a layered approach and make sure that you have controls that you put in at each of the different touch points across the customer lifecycle. When you're first vetting an applicant, that's the best time to try to, you know, discourage this type of activity from entering your institution, because that's the best place to stop it. But to your point, a lot of times because they can lay in wait for a long time and you know, do a lot of different things over time, depending on the purpose of the identity, depending on what they're potentially using it for, depending on where it fits in their overall scheme, that they need to be able to then, you know, if they get through the front door because you can't turn them all away, then you do need to monitor them over time and to understand what's going on as they're transacting, as they're maturing, or even to go back through and kind of retro-score an existing part of you know, your portfolio to see, okay, you know, what's happening with this book of business now or what's happening with this now. And I think it's also really important, besides taking that layered approach, making sure you have effective communication between each of the quote-unquote silos within an organization, because everybody all day long has a lot to do, probably more than they can do in a day, and very limited resources. But they also need to know that this doesn't operate in a vacuum. It won't just stay along the fraud lines, because these people are technically who they say they are. That's who they told you they were. So, you know, it may fail through fraud, but then there's a credit implication or an AML implication or a compliance implication. So being able to have some of those different organizations talking with one another and working together so that the organization can see the threat as a whole versus in kind of their just the line of sight that they see during the day. I think working with law enforcement and industry groups is really key too, because the trends change fairly quickly. Different threat vectors happen to different organizations based on their product mix, based on their control infrastructure, based on their appetite, and understanding how your organization's being targeted or proactively looking for ways for your organization to be targeted are really critical in defending against this type of fraud.
Great, thanks. And just one more before we go to the back to the audience for questions. As I look at your slide and I see the many states represented, a lot of rural states here, which are basically populated with community banks, middle-sized banks. And have you seen through your discussions and or your work with the FBI, or Zach, feel free to chime in, were many of these small financial institutions or medium-sized that were hit? Because that's where we see, I'd say, sort of a lack of deep understanding about some of these. So any evidence from some of the things you've worked on, whether they are targets, the smaller ones?
Absolutely. I'll tell you, fraud actually knows these guys are equal opportunity offenders. So small, medium, large, they really don't care. The exploits change depending on the size of the bank and the product mix that they have and kind of what looks like their quote-unquote best customer. But they are in every bank that we've ever done investigations on. I may have come from big banks, but when we partnered outside of the institution I was working for and since I've stepped out of the industry altogether, they target different banks in different ways, but I don't think that there are any really immune to this type of fraud. We've seen them in federal credit unions. We've seen them in local community banks. Obviously, they're in, you know, they're wherever the money is, to be honest with you. I haven't seen any that haven't really been targeted in some way, shape, or form, unfortunately.
Yeah, great, thank you. And maybe I'll pass back to you to see what, Zach, did you want to add?
Yeah, I just wanted to also touch on that, and I agree with Amy. They're opportunists. They'll look at any way to take advantage of any product or any other opportunity to make money. You know, you got to think about it, just the way in which we're discussing this today in a forum and talking about it and educating, they're doing the same thing, only how to combat what we're trying to do. So it's just something to keep in mind.
Great. Thanks, Zach. Marielle, let me turn to you to see what's out for the audience from questions.
We have lots of questions, some of which I will ask as is, some of which I will combine because they've been coming in fast and furious as you're talking. One of the questions about crime rings, is most of this happening through domestic fraud rings? It's for either one of you.
I can touch a little bit on that. The answer is no. A lot of it does come overseas. The nice thing for normal consumers about peer-to-peer transfers and, you know, the internet is it's shrinking the world and making business easier, but it's also making it easier for the criminals to do and exploit. Sometimes we've even seen back in the day them sending groups over here to operate. One instance, I had a case where they were sending a group from Europe. They were coming here on a weekly basis, coming in for a week, leaving for a week, coming in for a week, just to commit some of these frauds. So this is a transnational crime. It's not just a domestic crime. So the one thing, though, where it does affect us more is just because of what Jim talked about earlier, is the system we have in place and how the card payments are getting placed. I think that what we're seeing is there's a lot more of our systems being jeopardized through the bust-out scheme, unless Amy has something to add to that.
Yeah, so I agree. I think I see it very similar but slightly differently. So for the transnational organized criminal groups, from my perspective, tend to be the ones that have really taken this to an enterprise type of exploit. And they are highly sophisticated, highly organized, and very tactical in their exploits and very well versed on the infrastructure. Now, because of the data breaches and the PII information that's gotten exposed and is available either through the dark web, or there's plenty of stuff on the surface web, because this is getting traction and institutions are paying attention to it, it's also out in social media, and the recruiting that's happening and what they call CPN schemes or credit profile schemes, people that didn't used to be involved in it, used to be exclusively, back when this case was first happening, it was pretty much exclusively for the organized stuff, transnational organized crime. But now, because there is a lot more understanding of it and they've taken to, a new money-making opportunity for me is to sell how to do this and profit off teaching others how to do it, you're starting to see, or we're starting to see, some of the more domestic stuff creep in. And it's not from an organized criminal perspective. It's more of living beyond your means and getting access to things that you can't afford on your own, or gaming the system. But we're definitely seeing that is creeping in and becoming much easier to do and much more mainstream. But the legitimate, sophisticated threats are definitely with the transnational organized criminal groups.
Great, thank you. I do have another audience question. As people are thinking about accounts being opened with false date of births and social security numbers, where's the point of failure? Is it because financial institutions are using manual methods to verify information against credit reports, or is this a failure of some of the tools, Amy, that you mentioned earlier, that they're just not sophisticated enough to capture this? It's happening underneath.
I think it's a combination of things. I think some of it has to do with, there's a lot of assumptions that the system's doing something that it's actually not. I think also, too, that we have a system of we come in the U.S., you're innocent until proven guilty. So the absence of a negative infers that it must be positive. Not it should be more of the absence of a negative may mean I just might need more additional information. I also think some of the failure comes in, and I don't necessarily think failure is the right word. I think the infrastructure is just set up. I think people don't understand the nuances of it and where the handoffs are. And I think one of the things that tends to exacerbate this issue is the issue of friction. So anybody working inside a bank, customer friction or slowing anything down or having to make something more cumbersome or less instant is something that tends to that's where the trade-off comes. You either have to go, I want to make sure this is the easiest, most seamless process, or I want to introduce potential mitigation and fraud types of controls into it. And a lot of times that's where the rub hits, because by and large, most people are good and most people are who they say they are. It's a small portion that isn't. It's a growing portion, but that portion of the people who aren't who they say they are, or synthetics, they might be sub 1-2% of the full population, but they're attributing to 10-20% of all of the losses. So you have to play that balancing act of how much do you want to intercede, or how much do you want to, cause friction for verification or for additional hurdles when the overall percentage of the population isn't who you're looking for. So it's a disproportionate number you're going after, and you're just walking a tightrope of, making sure that you're keeping customers happy, making sure you're having a frictionless process, and managing your risk all at the same time. So it's a very delicate balancing act.
The other thing I want to add, too, is that what we're seeing is there's also different ways they approach it. Sometimes they'll do a blitz attack where they'll just, apply to anything and everything, and there's certain people in certain criminal organizations, that's all they do all day, is they'll just apply to credit lines, and they'll do hundreds of names, they'll do it at different institutions almost simultaneously. And, you know, some of them are going to get through. The intent is not to get all of them, it's just to get some of them. And then when they get one in, then they just try to repeat that to get as many as they can. The other thing, too, is they'll do a targeted attack. If they know one institution's weakness, they'll target that weakness and exploit it. And the other point that we didn't touch on is the point of insiders. Some of these organizations will put insiders within a business just to limit that friction. So they have a person to go to. We had one instance where there was an employee that worked actually in several branches of the same institution, and all they were doing is opening accounts and letting synthetic go through. So that's just something to keep in mind. The other thing, before I go to touch on, is with insiders, we are seeing a decrease in reporting through SARs. So that's another thing. If you have any indication of an insider institution, please put that in the SAR or make a direct referral to us.
Thank you. Zach, this next question is for you. What steps does your office take to keep in front of new techniques being used by bad actors? How have these bad actors modified their practices, and how are you keeping up with them?
Again, so a lot of outreach and engagement with the private sector. SAR data is big, going through what's being pushed out there. We have sources in the field that kind of tell us what's going on, leads generated through other investigations. And as far as the technology, that's something I don't want to get into on what we're seeing. I will say that what we are seeing is they are definitely using technology that's out there, that's readily available. We see a lot with the virtual currency, that's been increasing. And the other things I can't really touch on this forum, but I'd be happy to discuss through another channel.
Great, thank you. One of the questions that came in had to do really with kind of detection and whether biometrics might be helpful in detecting this, and that's for either panelist.
I think there's a role for biometrics. I just think with every technology that's out there, you have to understand how it can be weaponized against your institution. So I think that they play a good role. I think that it's important, but I also think you have to take a measured approach when you're doing that, because there are ways to be able to falsify that information. You just don't want to over-rely on anyone, and it's not just biometrics. I think it's any singular technology. If you over-rely and assume that will catch it all or that will stop it all, you just don't understand what are the vulnerabilities of that specific type of technology, and then you just have to understand how it can be reverse engineered and how it can be exploited.
Yeah, this is Jim, just to add to that. Yeah, Zach.
Sorry, Jim. Also, just something on that topic is, I think it was within the past month, there was a major data breach for a biometrics company where a lot of people's biometrics data was stolen, just to keep in mind.
Yeah, I was going to mention that, but also what we've heard, some surprisingly high numbers are when you've asked for proof of things like electric bills, rent, things like that, they're producing them. You know, they're getting really good, I think Amy's referring to this, that they're really, really good at producing those things you've asked them to, driver's licenses. And also, one number I just can't recall it off the top of my head, but the number of these synthetic identities that were actually applied in person, surprisingly high, because they are either part of the ring or they've just hired mules to go in and act like the synthetics, and then now you think there's a person that is not really there. So I think some of the techniques, as Amy said, they're really sophisticated about trying to get around some of the normal ways.
Go ahead. To Jim's point, we've seen plenty. Yes, the digital channels, the mobile channels, the online channels are the path of least resistance because it's a speed play there. But we have seen plenty of pure synthetics, whether they have an insider, to Zach's point, or not, have no problem going in person or doing stuff face-to-face, because most people assume a face-to-face transaction is a deterrent for somebody who's committing synthetic identity fraud, and truly, a lot of times, it's not.
We're approaching the end of the hour. There were a couple of questions that were asking about synthetic identity fraud beyond the payment system. You know, where else are we seeing it? I think Zaki spoke to that a little bit. And one specific question asking about Medicare and Medicaid as a target, especially ACA enrollment. So although we're focusing on payments fraud, thought this would be of interest to the audience.
We have definitely seen it there. Sorry, Zach. Yeah, we've definitely seen it across pretty much any vertical where there's an opportunity to game the system or get a benefit payment of some form, whether it's through a transaction or through an actual policy. We've seen it in a lot of different government agencies, a lot of insurance companies, healthcare and companies, property casualty, bodily injury, workers' comp. We've seen it across a lot of different industries and a lot of different types of products in those outside of financial services.
Yeah, I agree. We've also seen it not just on the criminal side of the house, but on the national security side of the house. So it's all over the place.
On that reassuring note, I guess my last question we'll have time for, do you see fraudster behavior evolving in the future? Where do you think this is going? Zach, start with you.
Unfortunately, I think, again, that would be better addressed in a more private forum, and I'd be happy to discuss it offline. I don't want to give any nefarious actors listening any tips.
Agreed. What I would say to it is I think everybody needs to recognize that it's an equal playing field for fraud. And basically, if there's a way to exploit a product or a program or an infrastructure, or they're going to find that it's that proverbial game of whack-a-mole. You stop them in one spot, they'll pop up somewhere else. So every new technology that we offer up to be able to create a better customer experience can be weaponized to turn around to be able to be the next way they exploit the infrastructure. And that's been going on forever. But it's definitely in the conventional payment channels. If you look at the peer-to-peer payments or the digital payments, I don't think there's a place where fraud doesn't try to find a way to exist in some way, shape, or form.
Great. Thank you. We have several questions we won't have time to get to. And to Zach's point, a number of them are fairly specific to fraudster behavior. And this is probably not the venue for this type of conversation. But we did have on one of the slides contact information for the FBI and for Amy at Turnkey Risk Solutions as well. And certainly should note that this webinar is recorded and will be available on replay if it is of interest to any of your colleagues. With that, I'd like to thank everyone again for participating in the webinar. I also encourage you to watch for additional information to come from the Federal Reserve, including another white paper that we have planned for this fall. And we invite all of you to learn more. If you have not already joined the Fed Payments Improvement Community, please do so. We will have more information to come on our website, on social media, and we look forward to having additional webinars of this type to help further explore these and other payment security issues. So I thank you all for your time, and have a great rest of your afternoon.